Okay.
Good morning. My name is Ondřej Mirtes. I'm from Prague, Czech Republic. And in this talk, I would like you to show you the advantages of using RabbitMQ in your applications. So who came to my yesterday's talk about WebSockets? Great, glad to have you back. So I would like to start by showing you multiple approaches how you can send an email from your application, which is a really common use case. And in this case, we are sending the email directly when processing the HTTP request by the user. So the user can be completing an order, he can be submitting a contact form, and we are sending the email while he is waiting for the response from the server. So he is seeing a loading spinner in his browser, and that's when we are connecting to the SMTP server. This approach has only one advantage, and that is that the email arrives instantly. But that's about it. It has a lot of disadvantages. User, of course, waits for the response longer, so the SMTP server can be slow, and the user has postponed the rendering of the success page when we tell him that everything is okay. So the user has to wait longer. Also, if the SMTP server fails, we have the dilemma whether we should show the error to the user or if he should stay silent and look like that everything is fine, but the user doesn't receive his email. But the user didn't make any mistake, so we probably shouldn't show an error to him. And also, we have no chance to repeat the sending of the email in case of failure, because the email is sent during the HTTP request, and that happens only once, and we have no other data about the email, so we can't repeat the attempt to send it again. Okay. Another option, which will be probably known to you, is that instead of sending the email directly, we write some data to the database for the email to be generated later by a cron job. And the cron job is run later by the cron tab, possible a few seconds or a few minutes later. Our PHP script is executed, and the PHP script picks up the queue of emails from the written database rows. This works, but the user spends his time waiting in his email client, refreshing his inbox, and waiting for the imported email, for example, with the order confirmation or with a link to a forgotten password reset, etc. And also, there's a lot of time, lot of idle time, which could the CPU of the server spend doing some useful things. But instead of that, it is waiting for the cron job to be run again. And also, you spend a lot of time writing the data to storage, and then looking for the data in the storage and reading them. So it's quite wasteful, and it's still not ideal. Also, if you run the cron every minute, but the cron gets longer than 1 minute, then suddenly you have multiple overlapping scripts reading the same data at the same time. So there's a possibility of duplicate emails sent, because when process A, that was executed by the cron job, reads a database row from the database and didn't mark it as sent yet because it takes a long time, and then process B comes and it reads the same line, you risk the possibility of duplicate emails sent to the same user with the same contents. So you can probably put some database logs and fail-safes to your code to prevent this, but its complexity increases and it leads to hairy code, and it's still very complex and error-prone. So to sum this up, sending an email through Cron has the advantage that user doesn't wait for the HTTP response. He gets it right away. Also, the attempts can be repeated. If the SMTP fails for the first time, you can repeat it. And the disadvantages are that the email does not arrive instantly because we have to wait for the next execution of our script. It is also susceptible to duplicates. And if we would like to have multiple threads sending emails at the same time, we can't, because it's really difficult to make it safe. So this approach is quite popular because of limited capabilities of shared web hosts, but it's very limiting. And if you have the option to manage your own servers, to install things on them, if you have some bigger application that makes money, you should probably invest into something more modern and useful. Okay, so as you can probably guess, my favorite approach is sending an email through a message queue. It's a very similar schema to the last one, but instead of writing a row to the database, we are sending a message with the data for the email to a message queue. The difference between Cron and this is that the email, the task to send the email, is picked up instantly. So the data arrive in the consumer, and the consumer sends the email. And good message queues guarantee exactly once delivery. So even if you have multiple consumers, multiple threads sending the emails at the same time, duplicates cannot happen if there's not a bug in our application, because the message queues guarantee exactly once delivery. Okay, so if you have a message queue set up for sending emails, because that's probably the first thing you should do, you can do a lot of other tasks through it. Basically, anything that can be postponed or is too much work for your PHP application during its time limit, during its 10 or 30 seconds, should be postponed to a message queue. So to sum this up, also user does not wait for the HTTP response. It can be repeated in the case of failure, same with Cron. It delivers the message exactly once. It's instant and it scales. And the cons are that it's quite a complex deployment, because it has a lot of moving parts. You have to configure a few more tools to have this working. You have to monitor a little bit more stuff, but I think it's really worth it. And also, you should watch out for some traps and gotchas, because this concept can be a little bit more difficult to grasp, and it can create new troubles in different ideas, in different areas, if you're not careful. Okay, so moving on to RabbitMQ. RabbitMQ is an open source technology. It's written in Erlang. which is a programming language that specializes in highly concurrent and parallel applications. And don't worry if you haven't heard about it. And RabbitMQ communicates with your application using AMQP, which stands for Advanced Message Queuing Protocol, and it communicates over TCP. And RabbitMQ has a really nice documentation because it's developed by Pivotal Labs, which make a lot of useful developer tools. They also make Redis, which also has a nice documentation. So anything made by Pivotal Labs has a really high quality. And RabbitMQ is basically a simple data structure. It's a queue, so that means first in, first out. And it specializes in one thing, and it does that one thing really well. So if you need some other features or properties from your solution, you should probably use something else, because RabbitMQ is a queue, and it would be a mistake to want something else from it. Okay, so message in a message queue can represent either a task. You want to do something. You want to send an email, you want to export some documents, you want to build a file, or it could represent an event. Something happened. User visited a product. User ordered something. And you can do stuff based on those things. So message is a string. It contains serialized data for the consumer in a chosen format. And I recommend using something platform agnostic like JSON, because then you can have consumers in different technologies, which you can then customize for your own needs. So it would be a mistake to serialize PHP array into a message data, because then you could have only PHP consumers. But JSON is also more readable when you are debugging your problems. Okay, so I would like to establish some terminology that RabbitMQ uses. Producer is basically your application which publishes messages to a message queue. So it can be your MVC controller, it can be a command line script, it can be anything that you run your PHP code on. Messages are not actually sent directly to a queue, but they are sent to an exchange. Exchange can represent multiple concepts. It can either forward the message to a queue, or, which is the most common use case, but different configurations are possible. For example, if your message represents an event, you can forward your one single message to multiple queues at the same time, and each queue can do something else with the event. So direct exchange forwards the message to a queue, and fanout exchange forwards the message to multiple queues, statically configured. Also, there's a topic exchange that can forward messages to certain queues based on configuration and the topic key contained in the message. On a queue, there can be multiple consumers listening for new messages. Consumer represents basically an open network socket which listens for new data coming in. And what's different in RabbitMQ from other message queues is that there's a central component, and the exchange and the queue and all the coordination needed around is containerized. It's inside a broker. So there's a central component running on your server, which is RabbitMQ. There are other message queues that don't have a central component and they rely on peer-to-peer messaging. So I think their disadvantage is that when you have no consumers running, you are probably restarting them or you are experiencing some crash, and producer produces messages, then those messages get lost because there is no one listening for them. So the broker represents some kind of persistent storage for your messages. The broker has, of course, a web user interface. You can use it to configure to broker, to monitor your queues, and also to publish and read messages from it from the same place that your application does, basically. This is a screenshot from our broker instance. You can see a lot of queues there. And in our application, each queue has a different purpose. So we can monitor them separately, and sometimes we even purge them. We truncate their contents if we want to. And because each queue has a different purpose, so we can decide that we can purge a queue because it's safe. For example, we have multiple queues for emails, and we have a low priority queue, which means that we send out newsletters several times a week. They consist of hundreds of thousands of messages sent over the course of several hours. So it doesn't matter if this low priority queue gets full, because no one is actually waiting for these messages. They can be sent over a course of several hours. But also we have a high priority queue for emails that the users ask for. So this high priority queue is always empty, always ready, and it sends out several emails per second at maximum. And it's for emails like order confirmation or forgotten passwords. What else we do with RabbitMQ is bulk operations. For example, in our administration, you can select multiple orders with a checkbox, and you can do mass operations, bulk operations on them. So some operations would probably take a long time, and our application has aggressive time limits, so it wouldn't make it in time. So we postpone those bulk operations to message queue. I think that your application can benefit from aggressive time limits. I mean in PHP INI, but also time limits like connection timeouts. Because if you set aggressive time limits, your users wait for a shorter time, and if anything goes wrong, you are the first to know about it. So aggressive time limits are really good. Besides bulk operations on our data, we also use RabbitMQ, for example, to prepare huge files to download. If we need to generate several megabytes worth of CSVs, we put this task to RabbitMQ, and we show the download link to the user when it's ready. And also we index documents to our Elasticsearch instance through RabbitMQ, because also it's something that can be postponed, and our employees, our users, are quite used to the fact that when they save something in the administration, it can take quite a few minutes to show on the front end. One reason for that is caches, but the second reason is that we postpone indexing these documents. And also, if you attended my yesterday's talk about WebSockets, you know that RabbitMQ can be used for inter-process communication between processes on your servers if you need them to talk to each other. This is how detail of a queue looks like in the web administration. As you can see, consumers listen to a specific queue. here in the lower part of the image, you can see six consumers from multiple servers listening on a queue in the broker. It's from multiple servers because they are differentiated by their IP addresses. You can really easily control the performance of your application by tuning the number of consumers listening for each queue. If some queue gets bigger, if there's a lot of messages queued up, you can add a number of consumers and the queue gets processed faster. And each consumer equals to a separate PHP process. So when you run a consumer, it equals to one consumer in RabbitMQ. And you can add the same PHP process with the same arguments, and the queue gets consumed faster. Okay, so we're finally getting to how to implement RabbitMQ communication in PHP. You might be probably familiar with this library. Who already uses RabbitMQ? Okay, so some people, so you probably use this library, and it's really popular, it's well-established one, but it's quite old. Its API shows its age, and I know a much better alternative that is called Bunny, and it's not mine, I didn't develop it, but I think it's really much better. So if you are just starting out with RabbitMQ, you should probably look into this library because it's the fastest alternative based on benchmarks from all the libraries for PHP. It has nice consistent API, and mainly it has both synchronous and asynchronous clients. So if you are using React PHP, you can really benefit from using this library. So this is how a message producer, the one that is publishing the messages, looks like in Bunny. You instantiate the client with some authorization for the broker. You connect to the broker. You create a channel. And in case the queue is not yet added, the queue with a certain name is not yet added to the broker, you can declare it before publishing the message. The first argument of the publish method is the string that should probably be your serialized JSON. It can also contain some headers, some metadata that can be useful, and you specify exchange to which you want to publish and the routing key. If you use the default exchange that forwards the messages to a queue, then the fourth argument, the routing key, is the name of the queue. It's really, really easy and straightforward. Okay, so what about the consumer? Consumers in PHP take the form of a long-running process, listening for new messages. As yesterday, you probably freak out when you hear PHP and long-running process in the same sentence, but let me show you, PHP is ready for long-running processes. Memory leaks don't happen anymore because of the language fault, but it requires some discipline, and to be able to run the process for a long time, you should be more careful on how you allocate memory and how you retain objects in your application. So basically means that if you create some object and you no longer need it, you should probably unset it from all the arrays and variables that it's referenced in. So for example, if you use a doctrine identity map, you should clear it regularly because the identity map tends to get bigger and bigger over time because it's basically a cache of all loaded entities in the process. This is how the consumer looks like. This is code that you should run on your command line. So you will probably use a Symfony console package for that. Who uses Symfony console here? Yeah, a few hands up. So the others probably don't write command line applications, or they use something else, I'm not sure. So the consumer code is also quite straightforward. You also have to connect to the instance, and you have to create a channel, and then you call channel run. And what you pass to the method is a callback that is called when a message is received by the consumer. And you have to talk back to the broker and tell him what happened to the message. If everything went fine, then you acknowledge that the message should be removed from the queue and it is already processed. Or if something goes wrong, for example, if SMTP connection fails, you should reject it. And reject has two modes. It has a mode when it throws the message away, or the message can be requeued. So if you find out that you are no longer interested in a message, if it's too old, or if it's from an old version of your application, you should reject it and it gets thrown away. But if you want to retry the message later in your application, you should requeue it. So you should pass second parameter as true to the reject method. And also it's important to note that if you receive a message and your process crashes before you have the chance to acknowledge it or to reject it, the message is requeued automatically in the broker. So if your process dies because of an exception, another process picks up the message because it is forwarded in the broker. So I have a little video, little demo. On the left hand side is a producer, command line producer, and on the right hand side is a consumer that is waiting for messages. And as you can see, the message is received by the consumer immediately. It's actually, the broker is not running on my local machine. It's running in Prague on our servers. So there's some delay, but it's immediate. You only have to count in all the network communication that is needed. So it's really fast. Okay, one more thing that you have to think about when setting up a consumer is prefetch count. Prefetch count is per consumer setting, how many messages should be preloaded in the consumer. Because receiving only a single message in your consumer represents significant overhead. RabbitMQ likes much more if you preload multiple messages in your consumer at the same time. Prefetch count one is ideal only for big messages. And by big, I don't mean the size they occupy on a hard disk, but I mean how much time does it take for a consumer to consume this message. So that's what I mean by its size. So if you have big messages in your queue, you should have prefetch count set to one, and the load is balanced across all consumers. If you have a higher prefetch count and you still have big messages that take a long time to be processed, this is what happens. All the messages are preloaded in the first consumer that processes them one by one, and the other consumers on the queue don't have anything to do. So this is not an ideal paralyzed scenario for this case. So higher prefetch count is great if you have a lot of small messages that take a short time to be processed, if they are quickly consumed by your consumers. So each consumer can preload a lot of small messages, and the load is still distributed equally, and everything works as it should. I talk about asynchronous consumers with asynchronous processing. If you are familiar with it, you can start processing first message. You can, for example, send an HTTP request to some third-party API, and while you are waiting for the response to come back, you can start consuming another message. So your PHP process has always something to do, and it does not spend its time idling. But of course, asynchronous processing needs higher prefetch count than one, because otherwise the broker wouldn't send you another message until you acknowledge the first one. So asynchronous processing, higher prefetch count, and use, for example, Guzzle for asynchronous HTTP requests, like you are used to from Ajax in the browser, for example. When you are deploying a consumer, you should probably have something to keep the processes alive, because PHP processes can die at any time when you throw an exception you don't catch, or where something unexpectedly crashes. You should use something like supervisor to monitor and to restart your processes when they go down. So supervisor is a utility written in Python, and what is great about supervisor for RabbitMQ consumers is that you can easily set the number of each, the number how many times each process should be executed. So you can tune the number of your consumers just by editing the supervisor configuration. And also, don't forget about the fact that when you are deploying a new version of your application, you should restart your consumers so they see the new source code, because without restarting, they would still work on the old version of your application without your bug fixes, etc. So don't forget that the supervisor can kill your process at any time if you tell it to during deployment. So your consumers should implement PC and TL signal to handle kill signals. Kill signal is, you are probably familiar with it, if you run something on your command line and you want to kill it, you press Control C. So that's basically a kill signal issued by the operating system. So you should expect and handle kill signals in your PHP process, so it does not get killed immediately, but you have a chance to finish the work of your consumer if it does something useful. This is how a web UI of supervisor looks like. You can see that we have multiple consumers of the low priority queue running. You can also see the uptime, and you can control the processes manually from the web user interface. So we're getting to the gotchas and traps. Don't worry, I will tell you all about them. But the downsides and problems of using RabbitMQ in your application are not fault of the technology, but it's rather the fact of how different it is when compared to how we are used to code every day. It's something really different, what we are not used to in PHP, because it's essentially parallel programming. Multiple threads of your code work hand to hand with each other. So new technology is sometimes blamed for our own bugs. I've heard multiple times when people talk about RabbitMQ that it is, for example, losing messages, but it was always fault of the application code when they debugged the issue. So when something behaves differently than you expect, it's probably of some bug in your code. So the first thing to note is that RabbitMQ is really fast. All these issues, all these solutions come from my personal experience, because first I did them the wrong way, and then I had to figure out what's wrong and why it behaves so strangely. So RabbitMQ is really fast. It's so fast that you will be surprised how fast it is. So if you have this code, you can see that some PHP method is beginning a transaction in the database, and you do some stuff, you insert some rows in the database, and after that you publish the message. And what's the trap here is that the message will arrive to the consumer before the database connection commit is called. So actually the consumer will see sometimes all data, because the message gets there before you have a chance to commit the transaction. Also, when you are publishing a message from inside the transaction, you probably do not count on the fact that the transaction can be rollbacked. So also a wrong message arrives in your consumer in that case. So you should always publish messages after the transaction is committed, just to be safe. If the consumer needs to see up-to-date data you did in the transaction. Something I already mentioned, you should clear your doctrine identity map. You should clear all in-memory caches before consuming next message, because otherwise the consumer will still see the old data than they are in the database, in case they preloaded them before receiving the message. So before, the first thing you should do when handling a new message from RabbitMQ is to clear your in-memory caches like doctrine identity map. Another thing that you might encounter is higher probability of deadlocks. If your users or your application manage to produce same messages at the same time with the same contents, for example, when first user saves some page in your administration, and then comes another user that also saves the same page in administration, you suddenly have two messages with the same contents. And in case they arrive to two different consumers at the same time, you might have a problem, because both consumers will attempt to read the same, to lock and read the same row in the database, which will result in lock wait timeouts or in deadlocks. So if you encounter this, it's really difficult to see this beforehand, but if your error logs gets filled with deadlocks from database, you should probably solve it by having a separate queue with only one consumer that you will aggregate your messages in. And from the consumer, you should have some timer that will filter those messages and produce unique messages, for example, every minute or every 5 minutes. So those messages can be forwarded to another queue, and from there they are safe to be processed in parallel. Another thing I wondered about is that some emails were sent earlier than they were asked to, than they were produced. It was really funny to see that some email was created at 1 p.m. and it was sent, for example, at 12:58 a.m. So that's because messages can be produced and consumed on different servers. So without synchronized time across the servers, it looks like the message was consumed sooner than it was produced. So sometimes that might not be an issue, but when you are comparing some date times, it can cause some problems. So you should synchronize times on your servers regularly, and you should also set up monitoring of the current time on each server for one original source of time. So when some server gets out of sync, you know that as soon as possible. which we didn't know. So when you receive a message in your consumer, you should check if your data is still valid, because RabbitMQ is instant, but your queues can get filled up because of some crash in your application or because your consumers are slow. So when you send a message to a RabbitMQ, you shouldn't rely on the fact that it gets processed immediately. Some facts, some data can change between producing and consuming message. So probably if your message references some deleted rows, you should probably reject it as soon as possible. But it can get more complex if your user, for example, creates an order and you publish a message on behalf of it, you probably think the message should be about valid, created, or paid order. But sometimes it can happen that the message is received by a consumer after the fact that the message was canceled or deleted, or the order about which the message is was canceled or deleted. So you should check that the data you are relying on are still valid before you do something about them. You should also think about backwards compatibility for old messages, because when you are producing a message, it can be consumed by a newer version of your application. So if you deploy a new version of your application and you update the format of the data of your messages and consumers rely on the new format, you can bump into problems, because there can still be some old messages in the queue waiting to be consumed. So if the messages are no longer valid, if you are not interested in them, you should reject them, but your consumer shouldn't crash because there's probably some key missing in your JSON, or the JSON has keys of different data types. As any system admin can confirm, redundancy is important. So you don't have to worry about RabbitMQ coming down. It didn't happen to me even once in 2 years we use it. But you should have some backup just in case the server on which the RabbitMQ is running goes down, the whole server goes down. So that's what is clustering and high availability for in RabbitMQ. RabbitMQ doesn't provide load balancing for performance. These techniques are just for backup, so you can continue operating even with a server down, and you don't lose any data. So to be able to have some high available RabbitMQ instances, you first need to add them to a cluster. You first need to set up clustering. So there are a few prerequisites. You have to have something called an Erlang cookie, which is a file with basically some password, and the password should be the same on each server that you want to connect to the same cluster. And there's a walkthrough to how you should start the cluster. So you should start the nodes independently on each server, and after they are running, you should set them to join the cluster from RabbitMQ CTL on the command line. And you should also check that everything is working with a cluster status command. This is quite a complex topic. You should probably check the documentation for details. They talk about every possible issue that can happen when setting up clustering. I like to refer to RabbitMQ documentation quite often, because it's really well written and readable, and it probably always answers all my questions. So when you have clustering set up, you can move on to setting up high available queues. So each queue in RabbitMQ has one master and mirrored slaves on other servers in the cluster. The master and slave pairs can differ between each queue. So one queue can have master on one server, and another queue can have master on another server. So also, it doesn't matter to which server you connect, because if you connect to the wrong server, the RabbitMQ automatically reroutes your connection to the server on which the master lies on. So for example, if I have a consumer and I want to consume Q1, and I connect to the wrong server, I connect to server A, but the master is on the server B, the RabbitMQ automatically reroutes the connection to the server B. If I connect to the correct server, if I want to consume Q2 from server A, it just works as expected. There's no rerouting. And in case one server goes down, the slave of the oldest slave on a server on a different server gets automatically promoted to master. So as you can see, the Q1 slave on server A is promoted to master if the server B goes down. High availability is also a complex topic. There's a lot of things that can go wrong. For example, network partition, some network corruptions, and you should also check the documentation for details and also to prepare yourselves for everything that can go wrong. Okay? Thank you for your attention. Please leave some feedback for me at this website. You can use the QR code. Do you have any questions? Okay.
I'd like to ask if it is possible to include a file in the message. And if yes, is it a good idea?
Well, RabbitMQ doesn't like very much big messages that occupy a lot of space on a hard drive. You should probably save the file somewhere else and refer to its URL or to its path on a file system. It's better.
What do you think about Redis queue?
Users of Redis use it for multiple different things. It's a very, very good persistent storage, and you can also hack it to act like a message queue, but I don't think it's ideal match for this use case. RabbitMQ is from the same developers as Redis, as far as I know, so there's no benefit to use Redis for that. You can set up RabbitMQ for this.
If your consumer will consume a message and won't acknowledge that it's processed it properly because it dies or something, then how the Rabbit will know that message is ready to distribute it to another consumer?
Well, the message is forwarded to another consumer if the consumer that first received it dies, or if the consumer tells the broker to reject the message, then it gets forwarded to another consumer.
But how will it know it died?
Sorry?
It will know it died because it will disconnect from Rabbit, or?
Well, the message is recurred if there's a network disconnect or if your process crashes, basically if the connection between the broker and your consumer is interrupted.
Okay, thanks.
Anyone else there?
Hi. If one task, one message in queue is existing through a long time with many probes of repeat, can I remove manually in queue by Rabbit Web Management Panel?
Yeah, you see all the queued messages in the management panel. And I think there's also a header that says how many times it was retried, how many times it was retried, but I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
In the back.
Hi, did you encounter this problem that a particular message kills a worker? And did you, what was your experience with this problem?
Sorry, what problem?
That a particular message kills a worker, produces a fatal error, an exception, and
Yeah, if a message kills a worker, then the message is recurred at the back of the queue and tried again.
So it's possible that it kills another worker because the message is malformed, is incorrect or something like this, or maybe you didn't have this problem.
Yeah, RabbitMQ with its default configuration will retry the message infinite times, but you can reconfigure it to after several attempts, you can reconfigure it to fall into something that is called dead letter exchange. You can read about it in the documentation, DLX.
During presentation, you show us aggregating consumer. Do you have approach for aggregating consumer? You have to do it manually, or RabbitMQ has mechanism inside, for example, detect that the message is similar, so you cannot, you don't want to send two times.
That's completely manual in our application. As I said, RabbitMQ does one thing, does it really well, and that's queue data structure. So anything else, any other logic, you have to implement yourself. So aggregating consumer is basically consumer on a queue, and it's the single one consumer on that queue, and you have you can put your logic in there.
How you manually your advice because you have huge experience, I think. You do it in your project. For example, how you detect? Yeah. For example, you have one queue with a bunch of jobs to do, for example, I know more than 300, and how to detect in fast way repeatedly in queue, for example, two jobs the same.
So you can, for example, use PHP array for that with keys. So if two messages with the same ID come, you put them in a single index in an array. So that's the uniquing the messages.
Ah, okay, thank you.
Okay, so anyone else? Okay, so no hand up. Thank you very much.